There was no crushing that spirit. You should have seen Cochon defeated again, and he had not dreamed of such a thing. I heard it said the next day around the town that he had a full confession all written out in his pocket and all ready for Joan to sign. I do not know that that was true, but it probably was, for her mark signed at the bottom of a confession would be the kind of evidence, for effect with the public, which Cochon and his people would particularly value, you know. No, there was no crushing that spirit, and no beclouding that clear mind. Consider the depth, the wisdom of that answer, coming from an ignorant girl. Why, there were not six men in the world who had ever reflected that words forced out of a person by horrible tortures were not necessarily words of verity and truth. Yet this unlettered peasant girl put her finger upon that flaw with an unerring instinct. I had always supposed that torture brought out the truth. Everybody supposed it. And when Joan came out with those simple common-sense words, they seemed to flood the place with light. It was like a lightning flash at midnight which suddenly reveals a fair valley, sprinkled over with silver streams and gleaming valleys and farmsteads, where was only an impenetrable world of darkness before. Manchon stole a sidewise look at me, and his face was full of surprise, and there was the like to be seen in other faces there. Consider, they were old and deeply cultured, yet here was a village maid able to teach them something which they had not known before. I heard one of them utter, "Verily, it is a wonderful creature. She has laid her hand upon an accepted truth that is as old as the world, and it has crumbled to dust and rubbish under her touch. Now, whence got she that marvelous insight?" The judges laid their heads together and began to talk now. It was plain, from chance words which one caught now and then, that Cochon and Loiseleur were insisting upon the application of the torture, and that most of the others were urgently objecting. Finally, Cochon broke out, with a good deal of asperity in his voice, and ordered Joan back to her dungeon. That was a happy surprise for me. I was not expecting that the bishop would yield. When Manchon came home that night, he said he had found out why the torture was not applied. There were two reasons. One was a fear that Joan might die under the torture, which would not suit the English at all. The other was that the torture would affect nothing if Joan was going to take back everything she said under its pains. And as to putting her mark to a confession, it was believed that not even the rack would ever make her do that. So all Rouen laughed again, and kept it up for 3 days, saying, "The sow has littered 6 times, and made 6 messes of it." And the palace walls got a new decoration, a mitred hog carrying a discarded rack home on its shoulder, and Loiseleur weeping in its wake. Many rewards were offered for the capture of these painters, but nobody applied. Even the English guard feigned blindness and would not see the artists at work. The bishop's anger was very high now. He could not reconcile himself to the idea of giving up the torture. It was the pleasantest idea he had invented yet, and he would not cast it by. So he called in some of his satellites on the 12th and urged the torture again, but it was a failure. With some, Joan's speech had wrought an effect. Others feared she might die under torture. Others did not believe that any amount of suffering could make her put her mark to a lying confession. There were 14 men present, including the bishop. 11 of them voted dead against the torture, and stood their ground in spite of Cochon's abuse. 2 voted with the bishop and insisted upon the torture. These 2 were Loiseleur and the orator, the man whom Joan had bidden to read his book, Thomas de Courcelles, the renowned pleader and master of eloquence.